Hello, and thank you for joining us for Quaker's webinar with Automotive Manufacturing Solutions. I'm Nick Holt, editor of AMS Magazine. Today, I'm joined by Mikael van Bremen, technical research manager at Quaker Chemical Corporation. In this webinar, Mikael will describe Quaker's work in simulating non-ferrous cut and roll tapping in the laboratory, discussing the results of the work conducted to develop test methods to predict performance of metalworking fluid in thread making operations. Before we begin, I'd like to invite all of you to send questions to Mikael to pick up in the Q&A session following the presentation. Just type the questions into the lower right-hand side of your screen. Also, if you experience any technical issues during the session, please let us know using the Q&A box and our team here will try to fix it. We hope you'll find this webinar stimulating and informative. And with that, I'll hand over to Mikael to begin the presentation.
Well, thank you, Nick, for the kind introduction. So, hello everyone, and thank you for tuning into this webinar. I will be talking today to you about tapping technology and how Quaker utilizes this to enhance our coolant technology. In the bottom of this slide, you'll see my email address. So, if you have any further questions after this webinar, please feel free to contact me. So, let me start by introducing Quaker. As you can see on this map, Quaker has a global presence. We have 40 locations in 21 countries, which are situated in all continents of the globe. Our headquarters is situated in Conshohocken, Pennsylvania, in the US. And I'm located in the Netherlands, in Europe, where we have our EMEA headquarters. And also, there are our main research and manufacturing facility for EMEA region is situated. In total, we have a little over 2,000 associates that serve approximately 4,500 customers, with a total sales of 750 million, and we reinvest approximately 22 of those millions back into R&D. So, as Quaker is a major supplier of metalworking fluids to the automotive, the heavy equipment, aerospace, and other related industries, we spent significant research efforts in supporting the emerging trends in powertrain and drivetrain manufacturing. As such, we have invested in the last years quite heavily in technical centers that have fully instrumented CNC machining centers, which are located in five different regions. At the bottom of my slide, you'll see pictures of those CNC machines. On the bottom left, you see the picture of the USA Technical Center, which is located in Conshohocken. Then going to the right, we go to our Japanese Technical Center, our Chinese Technical Center, our Brazilian Technical Center, and the Technical Center, which is based in the Netherlands. So, in order to give direction to the innovation of our product portfolio, we actively follow the trends in the industries we serve. So, with the changing fuel economy, we see increased fuel efficiency and demand for lower emissions. You'll see engines being downsized. And as such, turbochargers are being implemented, and we see more direct fuel injection systems being used. It's asked for increased fatigue and high temperature strength requirements. And as such, we see that our customer base is shifting from the more traditional 390 and A380 aluminum types towards more ductile aluminums like A356 or LM25, as the British denotation is. And this is this shift is done because the mechanical properties is elevated, temperatures can be maintained. But this ductile aluminum, A356, also presents some machining challenges. This is, by the way, not the only factor that drives the shift towards A356. There are also other factors in place, like weight gains and some casting opportunities. So another trend we see involves, in fact, the metalworking fluid technology itself. So with the market expectations to continuously decrease the cost of ownership for metalworking fluids, and also with increasing performance requirements, we see metalworking fluid suppliers shifting towards lean and high performing microemulsions. And this can present machining challenges as well. As you can see on the graph on the left, I plotted tapping performance on the y-axis and coolant emulsion droplet size on the x-axis. And going from right to left, you'll see that when the droplet sizes decrease and the emulsions get more stable and you get into the microemulsion range, you'll see that the tapping performance drops and the machining and specifically the tapping operation becomes more challenging. So traditionally, tribology bench tests like Phylex wear tester and a four ball tester are being used on the laboratory to develop develop new concepts. These tests have a bad correlation with the machining process. So once new products have been designed by these tests, and you will directly go into field trials, this presents tremendous operating risks. So as such, Quaker has chosen to implement two intermediate steps. The first one is laboratory bench test, a tapping test, which I will explain in the next slide. And the other one is the CNC machining simulation centers, which I talked about a couple slides back. So these are two examples of laboratory bench tapping tests that we use to support our new product developments. The left one is the Tauro or the Taurox, and the right one is the well-known MicroTap tapping torque. Both of these machines are available at our development laboratory, and we use them to give direction within the development process. But these tests also come with serious limitations. First of all, they can only do tapping. Well, we know that other operations are also of importance, like they can only tap holes with external cooling. Thirdly, they can only tap blind holes because the coolant is applied inside of the hole. A through hole is not possible because then the coolant would run out. Fourthly, they have a limited machine rigidity, as they're quite small machines. You can't compare them in any way to a CNC machine, and they also come with some clamping limitations. Then another limitation is that you can't use compensating tapping tools in these bench tapping tests, which are quite oftenly used in the field. And lastly, but not least, there are only a limited amount of operations that you can conduct, as you need to do them manually. And both of these machines have a limited torque, which gives limits to the diameter of the tool and the speed you can use. So, as such, we always use as a last step in our new product development process a machining verification via a CNC process simulation, where we also include tapping, but also we include lots of other operations to evaluate the coolant performance prior to commercializing it. So when you're going to study the metalworking fluid performance, there are many variables that come into play. And there's only one variable that we want to evaluate, and that's the performance of the metalworking fluid itself. So that's what we call the study variable. Then there are some other variables that we need to control. The first one I just talked about, that's the machine itself. So to achieve a full correlation, we aim to use the CNC machine for that. But there are also some other variations that come into play. Examples are the tool-to-tool variation, chip disturbances, and ingot quality. All of those three I will talk about in the next couple of slides. So when we would talk about the quality of a tap, but also other tools, Quaker uses the Zoller-Smile machine to check the cutting angle tolerances to make sure that the tool-to-tool variation is within an acceptable range. Next to that, for our tapping test, we use a self-designed calibration fluid by which we check every tap before use, and it should fulfill very well-defined torque specifications before we will even use it to test the performance of a fluid. When we want to reuse the tool, as we think the tool still looks okay, we first remove any galling through etching, and then we check the tool again with the calibration fluid before we use it again in the further tap test. So besides the tools, you also have the ingots. And in the picture on the right, you can see the ingots that we use. We have this is self-designed by Quaker. You'll see that this is a cross-section. You see that the hole will be filled a little over what's here in the picture, approximately to this cutting edge with the cutting fluid. And then this pocket will be filled once the tap enters the hole. And this prevents any disturbance of chips or other debris coming from the tapping operation when the tap would enter the next hole. Another thing that we closely control is the quality of the ingots. As you can see in this picture, you can have casting defects, gas insertions, heavily influencing the repetition accuracy of your method. And another thing to closely watch, and that we currently have under control, is the heat treatment variations. So once you have conducted your tap test, you'll need to assess the results, obviously. So what we use to quantify the tolerance of the threaded hole is a diameter correction tool. As a second step, we often mill over the open the ingot, and we visually inspect the thread quality. Thirdly, we look at the tap. We see if there is any galling or buildup edge being formed, which is unwanted, obviously. And fourthly, we quantify the torque in the tapping process. So, as the heat is generated by the deformation strain as induced by the cutting method, but also by the friction associated with the rubbing of the flank surface of the tap and the chip, you'll see that as the chamfer enters, there is a sharp incline in torque until the tap is fully cutting. Then the incline in torque increases to a lesser degree, which is caused by the additional friction of the guide. Until the spindle is breaking, then the torque increases again a little bit until it drops back to zero once the tap has stopped moving. Then the direction of the tap is reversed. And then depending on the type of tapping operation, you will see that the torque increases again negatively this time for cut tapping, as the root chip needs to be sheared off the interior of the hole. Or for roll tapping, you normally don't see any increase in torque occurring further on in the tapping process. Then the tap exits the hole and the measurement is ready. And this process is repeated for numerous of times. Then once you have tapped a certain amount of holes, you take the average of the torque, and that's what you see plotted in the graph on the left. So here on the y-axis you have your torque, and on the x-axis you have five products being tapped with an M10 cut tap with a pitch of 1.5 with two different alloys. In blue you see A356, which is the alloy of interest, as we talked about with the industrial trend in the beginning of the presentation. On the right, we have a more traditional 380 type of aluminum. With the 380 in green, you'll see that for all five products, A, B, C, D, and E, that there is a nice, stable performance. it gives a low torque values with relatively low amount of variation, and there's not so much influence of the metalworking fluid quality that you use. For the A356, it's completely different. For product A, you see a fairly low torque, nice and stable behavior, low variation. But once we go to product B, C, and even D and E, we see for these two products, in a total failure. Failure in this case means that the tap has either jammed or that part of the tap has even been broken. So we can conclude that the influence of the metalworking fluid on the cut tapping performance is very much dependent on the type of alloy, where A356 presents itself as a very difficult aluminum type. A356 is a very ductile aluminum, and as such it produces longer chips. And as we're using a spiral tap with a closed hole, there is an increased risk for chipping issues and galling on these taps. So when we now for a moment compare cut tapping to roll tapping, you'll see here that in the red section of the graph, you see the same five products, A, B, C, D, and E, and the same torque picture as in the last graph, but now we will compare it to roll form tapping. Roll tapping is being done with accelerated speeds as comparison to the cutting operation. So as such, in general, roll tapping is seen as a more demanding operation. But when we now compare both tapping operations on our alloy of interest, which is the A356T6 or LM25, in the British denotation, with non-coated taps, we'll see that for these five products, A, B, C, D, and E, that there is a very stable torque values are observed with low variations. Only for product C, we see a little higher torque value, but still a very stable behavior. Product C, we have stress tested, by the way, on our CNC. We conducted 1,000 plus hole test, and we did not see any incline in torque. So the impact of the metalworking fluid in cut tapping on A356 T6 is much more significant for cut tapping than it is for roll forming. So when we now look at the failure mechanism of this cut tapping of A356, on the left we see a graph of a good metalworking fluid with a stable performance, and on the right we see a poor metalworking fluid with an unstable performance. Here you see the torque pictures of the tapping operation, where on the y-axis again there's torque, and on the x-axis in this time there's the time in milliseconds. So as the tap enters the hole for cycle one, which is indicated in blue, you see that the torque increases, then it remains stable, then the tap reverses its direction, and the torque goes nicely back to zero until the operation is finished. Then for cycle two, you see a repeat of this of this operation. It's almost like an exact copy. But when the quality of the metalworking fluid is poor, and you'll see an unstable behavior, you will see for cycle one, as indicated in blue, pretty much the same force field until the tap stops and reverses its speed. Then suddenly, as indicated here by the red arrow, you'll see that the torque fastly increases, and after exiting the hole and going into cutting the next hole for cycle two in yellow, you see that the torque steadily increases to an unacceptable high value, and upon retraction you see it peaking down also to a very high, in this case negative, torque value, and basically your operation is over, and you can throw away your tap. So the failure is often initiated at the reverse moment, as indicated by the red arrow, and the return forces are critically important to evaluate the tapping performance, specifically for cut tapping operations. So in this slide, I present a top view of the in and the out operation of a cut tap making the threat. So in the left picture, when the tap rotates clockwise and it's cutting off the chip over here until it enters the bottom of the hole, and then it stops, and the rotation is reversed, and it goes counterclockwise, and then it's this negative chamfer relief angle that needs to shear off the root chip upon reverse. And this presents a very high risk for smearing and galling. As indicated in yellow, this is the area where buildup edge formation can occur, and this is in fact the reason why this operation is so severe. And this mainly becomes apparent when you machine ductile aluminums like A356, where your aluminum contains higher silicon contents, for example, or copper contents, it becomes more brittle and the chip will break instead of being smeared in between this negative cutting angle. So what we have achieved is we have improved by adapting these testing methodologies. We have improved the alignment of our laboratory machining simulation with the current market trends. We inherently designed new tapping simulations to accelerate the innovation and to give a direction for new product developments. And currently, Quaker offers a global range of microemulsion metalworking fluids, which are specifically engineered to optimize aluminum machining performance, which includes the A356. And as part of our 7000 series, there was one product from the 7400 series, which is called the 7450, and one product from the 7200 series, which is called the 7251, which are specifically designed as well using these testing methodologies. So that leaves me by thanking you for listening, thanking AMS for offering me this opportunity. And I also want to refer to our website, quakercam.com, for any further information. And if there's any questions, I'll be happy to answer them for you.
Thanks, Mikhail. That was a very interesting presentation. We have got a few questions for you, so I'll start firing away with those. First question. What kind of advances have you made with fluids that make a difference with the tight emulsion?
Well, tight emulsion come with quite some benefits over fatty emulsion systems. In general, they have a better biostability properties. We also see lower consumption rates. Often, we were able to improve also the water hardness compatibility. We see and get the feedback of decreased risk for residue formation, and also we often see improved filterability properties. Next to that, these microemulsions often carry fewer oil and synthetic oils, and as such they also have a better carbon footprint.
Thanks, Mikhail. When you're talking about microemulsions there, a question here, when it comes to the microemulsions, have you seen benefits in other operations and what are the limitations?
Well, yes. Well, reaming is certainly a space where these enhanced emulsion stability yields performance advantages. However, it's been our focus to demonstrate those performance advantages more in the secondary fluid variables, like the consumption and the filterability that I just referred to, but also in the supply, for example.
Another question here, again relating to microemulsions, do they provide good biostability?
Well, the dominant factor that determines good biostability is, in fact, the activity level of the biocidal package that's implemented in the coolant, and also, of course, the maintenance intensity at the end user. However, they're tighter and more constant particle size allows for greater efficiency in slowing the impact of tramp oils, which gives longer bath lives and also improved biostability rates.
Thank you. We've got time for just one more question. There are some other questions, but we will pass these on to Mikhail after the webinar closes, and he'll be able to respond to those individually. So, excuse me, final question here. Broader question here, Mikhail. What microemulsions are you using with customers today? Have you got some examples?
Yeah, well, I gave two examples in the last slides, but we have several microemulsions in our QuakerCool 7000 family that demonstrate positive customer experiences, specifically in our 7400 and 7200 series. We have products running very well at OEMs, for example, at Honda, but also Fiat Chrysler Company, General Motors. And also some tier suppliers, which you can think of Bosch and JTECT. Another series that I can mention is the 7300 series that shows a clear added value throughout our distribution network that serves the tier three markets, for example. But best is also to refer to our local process engineers engineering team, which can help to guide the customers to the ideal fit for any specific scenario.
Thanks, Mikhail. Okay, we'll draw the Q&A session to a close there, and thanks for all of your questions. As I've mentioned, we'll pass all these on to Mikhail to follow up. We'd like to say thanks to Mikhail for a really informative webinar, indicating the sort of how topical it is with new materials that are now coming through, new requirements from customers and OEMs. As always, the webinar will be uploaded into the AMS archives and accessible in the future for you, any colleagues that have been able to join us, or if you'd like to listen to it again. And you can access this and all the previous webinars via the webinar tab at the Automotive Manufacturing Solutions homepage. We'd like to get your feedback on this webinar, and there's a short survey coming up, so we'd really appreciate it if you take the time to complete it. We really value your input on that. Thanks for taking part with us again today, and we hope you'll join us again for our next webinar. And with that, I'll say goodbye and thank you.